I met Ray about 2 or 3 months ago at the Arkansas Hospital Association for the American College Healthcare Executive Forum. So he's sitting up there, he's talking about mentorship, he's talking about resumes, he's talking about what it takes to be a top healthcare professional. So I raise my hand, I'm sitting in the audience, and I say, what does a guy like me do to show all my accomplishments with volunteering? And I list off everything that I've done, and then he goes, and I tell him I was the president and founder of the UCA Rotary Club at the moment. So he says, what does Rotary have to do with healthcare? And I don't know, that's the first question you asked me, right? So I told him that we got involved with the Governor's Healthy Act of Arkansas and that we were acknowledged for it. Only come to find out that has reached like the top level of success for a CEO of a hospital. During his years at Searcy Hospital, he has been the CEO for the last 27 years. He has a gang of accomplishments that I'm not even gonna begin to read off, but I can say that after shadowing Mr. Ray and seeing his hospital, you wouldn't even recognize that this hospital. So he has love for me, like great ambitions and big shoes to fill for me and my profession. So I just wanna introduce Mr. Ray Montgomery.
Y'all need to keep watch on Keith. He's going to be very successful in what he does. I'm trying to get him to move to Searcy. So it's a pleasure to be here. Thank you very much for this opportunity. And I'm sitting here thinking, well, what can I say that y'all don't already know? You've got two hospital facilities that are going to be here or have been here. Great active retail market. Two new malls coming in to play, and it's just a blessing to be down here, go through Conway an awful lot, and I want to congratulate you for the work that you all do in terms of your humanitarian work in this community and across the world, whether it's through your activity with polio or your youth programs or like. We need people, men and women, that are dedicated and committed to the level of dedication to their communities. And thank you for inviting me, Rick. I know Rick from way back, and Bob McCormick, the outstanding job he did in representing Conway Regional on the board and the work that has been done. Y'all have a great, active, thriving community here. And I have to tell you that healthcare is changing, it's dynamic. I've been in Arkansas for about 28 years. Fortunately, I keep moving around, so it's hard for the board to hit a moving target, and so it's kind of good that I keep doing things. But we feel real blessed and honored that we're part of Arkansas and what healthcare is trying to do for our friends, neighbors, patients, and everything. I'm going to share with you a little bit of our little world in Searcy and some of the uniquenesses that are going on, reflecting a lot of the reason why probably you're experiencing some of the dynamic and changes that are occurring here. A couple of years ago, we saw the potential impact that the Accountable Care Act, commonly referred to as Obamacare, was going to have on healthcare. And as we look to see that those changes that are going to be forced upon us, some good, some not so good, how do we change and modify that? And so we began to look around and try to identify our role in our community. And back in 2007, we merged with one of the two hospitals in Searcy to become a single provider in a town about 25,000 population. I think Conway's about 60,000 or maybe upwards, and certainly a lot of traffic comes through here with the interstate. Our size community cannot sustain two hospitals. And so through that transition, we created a North and South White County Medical Center. Probably about a year ago, we partnered with a hospital in Newport. It was a for-profit hospital, may or may not know, Community Health Systems. And to bring White County into a Jackson County, and it expanded into Heber Springs, Claiborne County, to bring a White County into another Claiborne, or another county, that didn't make sense. And some of you out there that have much better wisdom than I do on marketing and branding and that type of thing, we went out to the community and said, okay, if we transition, what do we need to become? And so that's the formation of Unity Health, with the feedback of our community. And a lot of symbolism there, a lot of messaging that we tried to reflect. If you look at the logo design there, it's a multicolored, and it represents links, and we've created our own value links. And you can look at some of the symbolism there. Our focus on strategic planning is on four strategic areas: kindness, expertise, excellence, and stewardship. Then we're also not only just treating a physical presence, but you know as well as I, when you go into a healthcare environment, you're dealing with so many different things: the physical, the emotional, mental, and the spiritual elements. And for a healthy environment, creating the most successful environment to heal someone, you have to focus on those elements as we work through. So as a result, I mentioned to you, we had the opportunity to try to expand and reach more people. Oftentimes we talk about now patient-centered medical homes, population health, and we're emphasizing a greater penetration. That's kind of why probably Baptist has come into this market. A lot of patients have come from the Conway area and in this region. You've had an excellent facility in Conway Regional with many of the awards and recognitions that they have received over the years. And so it's an attempt to try to reach and meet the needs of people on a regional basis. These are some pictures of our three acute care facilities, two of which are in Searcy and one's in Newport. Then we have a real smattering of a partnership of physicians. You can't have healthcare and be independent of one another nowadays. CMS is talking about accountable care organizations. They're talking about bundled payments. And in order to divide up the dollars and help, hopefully try to control the healthcare dollars, you're dealing with the cost in the hospital. You're dealing with the cost in the home setting. You're dealing with the cost in the clinic environment, and whether you're a primary care or a specialty facility. And so we're seeing ourselves needing to partner and put together these, what they're calling, what we call integrated delivery systems, to where we can bring you value of quality and we can help reduce the cost of healthcare to you, because it's unsustainable. You know as well as I, many of you who have insurance, if not all of you, whether it's on the commercial side with your companies, or whether it's on a Medicaid state-funded or a CMS federal-funded, the sustainability. We're something like the 25th in quality indicators around the world, highest quality country, but we're number one in costs. And that's another project you can have me back to share with you, but there should be a congruence there. If you're paying for those resources, wouldn't you think you'd have the most and best quality service to provide to our communities? Here's a list of many of the clinics that were primary care and specialty areas. About almost 8 to 10 years ago, we built a Cancer Center of Excellence and partnered with RAPA, who is a radiation system, CARTI, and then the oncology clinic. So it's trying to find opportunities that we can work and partner with a variety of different people. These are the clinics in Newport that we partnered with. I can tell you, you know, Newport is about 7,000 population. Almost 10 years ago, they had two hospitals. Now they can barely keep one hospital operating. And so, you know, I boldly, humbly say, if we had come into that facility, they'd probably lose their hospital. not being critical, just fact of life. So we're working with them to partner with them to try to keep their hospital and their physicians local. We were blessed about 2 years ago with making plans for expansion of what I call growing our own. The work and the success that you're doing, the retail businesses, you're growing your own locally and providing that. Healthcare, there's such a shortage. I applaud UCA and some of the programs here locally and the allied health professions. We decided to expand and develop really the first residency program outside of the work that UAMS is doing. We foresaw that two medical schools are formulating in Jonesboro and Fort Smith. I may have some information on here. I'm getting a little bit ahead of myself. Healthcare is a major shortage in hospital and physician recruiting and retention. I know, Bob, you are well aware of all the work that's been done to try to recruit physicians to this community. Two new osteopathic programs, one starting in August of this year, one starting in August of next year. Together, they'll have about 265 graduates looking for residency program in 4 years, 2020-21. Is much larger than the 150 that are going through UAMS at the present time. So literally, we'll have almost twice, a little better than twice, the number of medical school graduates that are looking for a residency program. Residents, when they stay 50 to 70 miles in the residency programs, they tend to stay locally. So we hope with our program, we'll be able to have the 3 and 4 year programs there, hopefully retaining those physicians in our region. We've started a family practice program last year, psychiatry and internal medicine. And then this year, July 1st, we started our emergency medicine. Most of which, you know, if you look through that list, it's all primary care. Most of Arkansas is rural. We need a lot of primary care, so we're bringing these programs into fruition. We need more residency trained programs in Arkansas. And so we're working with UAMS, we're working with other hospitals. I hope that Baptist in Conway and Conway Regional will consider expanding and developing these programs. We'll have about 70 to 80 residents over a 3 to 4 year period of time. But in any given year, we only have about 80 additional slots for that 265 graduates that are looking for residency slots. So we need other hospitals that will step up to the plate and develop these training programs that will hopefully recruit and retain people, physicians to our communities. We announced back in May a venture that has taken us about 2 years to build a relationship. We've established the first relationship with Mayo Clinic in Arkansas. There are about 40 hospitals and systems across the world that have developed this relationship. It's really an attempt to bring that level of skill to our local communities. So if you think about this, and some of you probably have had loved ones or family members who've gone to MD Anderson, Cleveland Clinic, Mayo Clinic. When we looked around about 2 years ago thinking about how do we push ourselves to that world-class level care, we went around investigating hospitals and systems that have world-class care. And arguably, Mayo is always in the top five of world-class care across the country. When Mayo puts their name up with yours, they don't do this as an accident. They don't do this for the money. They do this for a recognition, prestige, and the feeling that they're bringing their branding and their quality of service to those areas. So it literally took us 2 years to build this relationship for them to investigate us. I don't know about your, you know, some of you in banking, you know, the auditors that come in, they scrutinize. Well, think about having an auditor in your facility for about 2 years. That's essentially what this took. And they said, we agree, we think you're a quality institution and we'll partner with you. And so we announced this back in May, the types of services that can be brought to our community stem from about three different areas. The first is a knowledge extension. Ask Mayo Expert, it gives our physicians, we have about 150 physicians on staff, it puts us up with 4,200 physicians and scientists that are part of the Mayo Clinic system, and allows our patients, allow our physicians, allow our providers, allow our residents to be able to access their level of expertise. The second area is e-health services, e-consults, and e-tumor. So what can happen is a patient who needs some further investigation, a physician who says, I'm a little bit unsure, what they can do is we can put in a portal all of their scientific information, all the test results, everything that's been done, and send that to the Mayo experts. They can review that in about 3 to 5 days and get back the results. The patient doesn't have to go to Mayo, whether it's in Phoenix or Jacksonville or Rochester. All their data can go there. The experts can review and evaluate that patient and can send that data so the patient stays locally. There's no additional cost. You might think, well, you know, a patient might have additional cost, even if they transport themselves or family members going to a hotel accommodation. This service is free to the patient, and so it gets that expertise directly to that patient and gives them that world-class care. The last element here is healthcare consulting. We've got a number of different projects that we have going on, from observation units to improving our throughput, the emergency room, to other types of services that sometimes they've got expertise in, sometimes they can even learn from us. So it's that sharing at a national level, even an international level, that will improve care that will be available to our patients locally. So this is the what we have as a logo and a theme to provide our systems. The care network looks basically like this, and you can see there's countries around the world. As I mentioned, we're the only one, or should I say we're the first one. I'm sure there'll probably be more in Arkansas, because this is a great opportunity to bring that level of care to world-class services. But Integrys, if you're all at least familiar with Oklahoma, it's Oklahoma City, the largest not-for-profit system in Oklahoma. Then you have Methodist out of Memphis, Methodist in Dallas, Texas, and I'm sure this will continue to grow. They'll probably have about another 10 of these programs that they're talking about expanding just this year alone. A couple of additional programs that we've expanded into, behavioral health, mental health issues are growing leaps and bounds. 70% of our patients come through the emergency room have a comorbid condition centered around mental health. So we have been expanding our services there. Supportive care, many of you know about hospice care, but palliative care is expanding, so that we're dealing with chronic diseases and trying to manage those patients in the last 2 or 3 years of life, rather than waiting to the end point that somebody goes. When you think about hospice, oftentimes people think it's a death sentence. So we want to develop these supportive care services and helping the family and the patient make decisions as they move towards the eventual end of life. I don't know whether you all know this, but we're all mortal. We're all going to die someday, so we have to face those realities. And these programs offer higher quality of care, higher degree of patient satisfaction, collaboration with the experts to make these best cares happen. Oftentimes, the care can be rendered in a home-like setting or the most ideal setting the patient direction wants to have, and then obviously, too, it's cost-effective. Telemedicine. We're embarking on telemedicine, trying to reach out to some of the other underserved areas of bringing the specialist into the primary care role, so where the doctor doesn't have to necessarily go into that location. And we're all busy, getting busier, but being able to track and provide those services closer to the patient experience. And last and not least, because as we're moving more towards a regional approach, the access of getting the patients to and from different locations in a more expeditious fashion is going to be essential. So there's times where the ambulance service works very well and can appropriately take care of that patient. And then there's times where literally minutes is essential, and being able to get that helicopter service to that patient and get them to the right place is critical to mortality rates improving upon the quality of life. I think one of the reasons why Mayo was interested in us, I'm not going to tell you we're world class, but we're striving to reach that level of excellence. We have received a number of different awards over time. We're, for the third 6 month period in a row, the only hospital that has received an A score in our safety scores from LeapFrog. AFMC is a state quality measure, and we are recognized almost every year for our quality elements there. We're a Health Strong top hospital in the country, one of probably about 100. We have patient satisfaction scores that are very high. Energy Star rating, many of you have bought recently, refrigerators, freezers, washer and dryers, they get Energy Star rating. And we're one of 34 hospitals in the country that have a 5-star rating for our safety and efficiency endeavors. We're at the 75th percentile, but we want to be upwards of 80 and 90%. And then a couple of other awards. We don't seek the awards just for the sake of being able to be prideful of those things. We do it because it's important to the patient. It's important to the community. We have loved ones that come into the hospital every day, and we want them to have the best care. We don't want them to have to go to Little Rock. We don't want them to have to go to Rochester. Obviously, we don't provide all the services, so we want them to go to the best when we don't have those services. But we do it for the patient. We do it for our friends and neighbors and our community. And so I appreciate the opportunity to share information. You got great organizations here. I encourage you to support those organizations. We have a lot on our plate, just as you do, each and every day. How do we improve? How do we provide facilities for the doctors and nurses and other clinical experts? Anything we can do to work collaboratively together. We're trying to develop a program with Morrilton for a RMA, registered medical assistant, because we can't find enough people to work in the physician clinic offices. So it's important that we collaborate together with the schools and universities and making sure we get the programs out there. I'm getting older. You know, the baby boomers are getting to that age. The demand is going to skyrocket, which means also the expenses are going to be incurred. So we want to try to do it in a cost-effective way. So with that, I hope I've allowed for a few minutes to give a question and answer period. I'll be here. If you don't get all your questions answered, I'll try to do that even after this. So if you have a question or comment, I'll attempt to answer them. Yes.
With your partnership, can we see that transpire throughout the state? I mean, by your partner at the different hospitals, like in the Delta area. So, do you see that happening in the future?
You know, absolutely. I was at a facility, Vera Health, out of North Dakota, and they're in a 6-county region with a telemedicine program. And they've got emergency room physicians, hospitalists, psychiatrists, and the like. I think places like the Delta of Arkansas, it's going to be very difficult to recruit specialists in there. But I think the growing opportunity of telemedicine is going to bring those physicians to those areas for care. If and when they have an acute need, I mean, obviously you have to go to a more metropolitan area. But I think so much can be done on a prevention and wellness basis that we'll continue to reach out and see the opportunities there and develop those programs. Well, if that's all, thank you very much. I want to give a thank you to Jim, as he put my computer knowledge base in there, so I didn't have to do it myself. So this is good for your notes that you're going to make with all this stuff that you have.
Well, thank you.
And then your president, she doesn't have a note binder there, so I'm going to give her this and let her take notes. And appreciate the opportunity to be here with y'all.
Thank you, Ray. That was very, very informative. And as a person that has visited the Mayo Clinic and our family has been very involved in the Mayo Clinic, that is very exciting news for those of us in Arkansas and several that have visited there. Our program has adopted a newspaper in education through the Log Cabin Democrat, and so we are going to donate 50 newspapers in your name to local schools. And so thank you again for being our speaker today. I really didn't know what to expect today, but that was very, very informative. I think I even whispered to Michael, I said, what a wonderful program. So thank you so much for bringing that to us today.